You have to make this?
Yeah.
You want me to put it in the office for 10 people?
Open it, that's the book.
Somebody burn something?
عليكم السلام. Yeah.
You do it on the Hack the Truth, or you want to change the channel?
Which Hack the Truth?
Hack the Truth channel, that the thing you do. I got them to that. I don't know the credentials for it. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، I welcome you brothers and sisters today. As I promised last week, we are going to study the Aqidah, which was mentioned by the great Imam Sufyan al-Thawri. The great Imam called Sufyan al-Thawri. Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, just in brief, something about him. He's one of the greatest scholars of Islam, such that you'll find in all of the six great books of hadith. And those are what? What are the six books of hadith? The main six books of hadith: Bukhari, Muslim, At-Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, Abu Dawud, and An-Nasa'i. In all those great books, the hadith which go through Sufyan al-Thawri are there. The hadith which go through Sufyan al-Thawri. I'm saying going through Sufyan al-Thawri because none of those six imams met Sufyan al-Thawri, but they met the students of Sufyan al-Thawri. So al-Thawri is the sheikh of their sheikhs. Al-Thawri is the sheikh of the sheikhs of Bukhari. He is the sheikh of the sheikhs of Muslim, like that. Like we mentioned here last week, and from the great imams of hadith who met with him, those who wrote books, is Imam Ahmad. Imam Ahmad, he met with al-Thawri. From what is said, Wallahu A'lam, maybe we'll have to recheck that. And Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, how do we know someone is great? How do we know someone is great in Islam? When the great people praise him, then you know he is great. As it is said in Arabic, لا يعلم فضل أهل الفضل إلا أهل الفضل. No one knows the greatness of the people who are great except those who are great. So if you look at the praise of his peers, especially his peers, and that is something rare to find contemporary scholars praising each other. It's usually the opposite, because that's how the human soul is. There's always something in the heart. But you find his peers, they all agree that he is someone great. And Sufyan al-Thawri, he was born in the year 97, Hijri, the year 97. His father, he comes from a scholarly family. His father, Sa'id ibn Masruq al-Thawri, was a scholar of hadith also. He was a scholar of hadith also. And he was encouraged, obviously, since young age to seek knowledge. And his mother used to get him ready. It is said that's how he started to seek knowledge. He said to him, go, I will take care of you, everything you need. Just go and study 10 hadith. If you like it, then alhamdulillah. If you don't, then don't bother yourself. And of course, he went, and the rest is history, as it is said. And you know, back then when they said go and study hadith, it meant what? Go and, yarhamkallah, go and collect hadith. So you go to the sheikh, he's going to tell you, so and so narrated from Abu Huraira, from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you memorize and you write. Sufyan al-Thawri is one of those people who memorized over 100,000 narrations. Over 100,000 narrations. It is said that Shu'ayb ibn Harb, one of the great imams of Islam also, he said about Sufyan al-Thawri, I think that on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell the people who came after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially those who are in the era, the same time of Sufyan, Allah will say to them, you never met my Prophet, but you met Sufyan. So what excuse do you have? That is how much they valued him. He's known as Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers in hadith. The leader of the believers in hadith. Imam al-Dhahabi, the great historian, he wrote one of the longest biographies about Sufyan al-Thawri. And he praised him a lot. And he praised him a lot. Rahimahullah. So today we are not going to be discussing about the biography of al-Thawri. You know, this is just a tidbit, as they say. Just a small thing for us to get to realize who we are talking about. Al-Thawri rahimahullah, obviously he was in Kufa. That's where he was born. And then he was one of those scholars who are very strict in terms of staying away from the leaders and the rich people. Because he used to say, when the scholar is close to the leaders, this was his opinion, you know, then it takes away that respect for him. It takes away that respect of him. This is how Al-Dhahabi wrote his biography. He said, "Huwa Sheikh al-Islam." He is Sheikh al-Islam, Imam al-Huffaz, the leader of all those who used to memorize hadith, Imam al-Huffaz, Sayyid al-Ulama, he is the chief of the scholars, Sayyid al-Ulama al-Amilina fi zamanihi, he is the leader of the scholars who used to be scholars of actions, not just scholars, but people of ibadah, Abu Abdullah al-Thawri al-Kufi al-Mujtahid, he was a mujtahid, meaning he reached the peak of scholarship, that's why people used to follow him in fiqh also. And I've said this so many times before. The four madhahib which are famous today, they were not the only madhabs then. The madhab of Abu Hanifa, the opinions of Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi'i and Ahmad, they were not the only scholars. Al-Thawri, like we just mentioned, he preceded Ahmad, and Ash-Shafi'i specifically. And people used to follow his opinions, just like people today follow the opinions of Ahmad and Malik and Shafi and Abu Hanifa. It's just that these other scholars, like Sufyan al-Thawri, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Abu Ishaq al-Rahawi, their opinions were not, if you want to use a word, instituted and used formally or officially in the land. They were not documented. That's why it died out. Well, these other madhai, the madhai we have today, the followers of these madhabs, they documented. That's why they were widespread. So this is a very brief biography of him, if you want to call it biography. And the small treatise we're going to read today, before I start, I want to make a disclaimer. Whatever website you see on this page, on the book, I'm not in any way associated with this website, and I would not encourage you to go to this website. It's a good book which I found there, and I took it from there and spread it with you. So nobody should hold me accountable for that. Taib, is that clear? Okay. It says, so I'm going to read, and as you know, whatever needs explanation, we'll explain. I don't see many young people here today, though. And this is how do you say it without hurting your feelings? Why are you laughing? This is not good. It's not good. I keep saying this. Bring your children to the masjid. Doesn't matter, your child is 5, 6, 7, 8, 15, 23. Bring them to learn, especially the aqidah, tawheed. It is extremely important. It is extremely important in this land. Because the war we are fighting is not the war. Someone is going to come and put a gun on your head. Well, that is happening already. People are being shot while praying. That's happening in Quebec, which you hope never happens again. But the war is an ideological war. Whether we agree to that or not, it's there. It says here, the creed of Imam Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri. The creed of Imam Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri. It says a word about this creed. Now the Arabic word is called aqidah. In English, you translate aqidah as creed. What is aqidah? Aqidah, it is taken from the literal word, meaning linguistic in Arabic, the word aqada, which means to tie a knot. You take something and you tie a knot. You take this and you tie a knot. That is what you read. You tie a knot like that. You read in Surah 2, what? أَمِنْ شَرِّ غَاسِقٍ إِذَا وَقَبْ أَمِنْ شَرِّ نَفَّثَاتِ فِي الْعُقَدْ. Those who blow into the knots. One is, عُقَد is plural. Because those who do magic, they tie knots like that, and then they blow, and then they say the words of shirk like that. Why is the word aqidah taken from the root word aqada, which means to tie a knot? That's why we call the contract of nikah what? Aqd al-nikah. That's why all contracts in Islam, in Arabic, they're called aqd. Why? Because you're tied to that. You're bound to that. It's binding on you. And the aqidah, which is the set beliefs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 25, 80 points of our beliefs. They are called aqidah. Why? Because they're matters which are supposed to be bound, tied to your heart. This is iman. This is belief. So it is called aqidah because they are the matters which are tied and bound strictly and firmly to your heart. That's why we call the creed, the belief system, we call it aqidah in Arabic. In English, the best word is creed. Creed. Because creed is more general than belief. It's more general than belief. Sometimes in translation, they use the word belief system. creed is just nicer. So this is the creed of Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, this great Imam. What was the creed he held? What was the set of beliefs he had? We have known how great he was. You know, they used to value him so much during his time. In fact, Imam Ahmad, he said, do not blind follow me, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. And do not blind follow Malik or Sufyan, he mentioned him, or Abu Hanifa. Rather, take from where we took. Do not follow us, we're just human beings. Not blind follow us. You should take from where we took. That shows you again how great he was. It says here, a word about this creed. This creed. Did you send these papers to the sister's side? Okay. This creed is mentioned by the Imam Al-La'laka'i in his remarkable book, Sharh Usul Al-I'tiqad, Ahl Sunnah Wal-Jama'ah. And he gave the page, the volume 1, page 151 to 154. Like I said today in the khutbah when announcing, in Arabic, the actual book, it's not a book, it's just 3 pages. Small set of points he mentioned. With his chain of narration leading back to Sufyan al-Thawri, may Allah have mercy upon him. And Al-Hafidh al-Dhahabi, he also mentioned that this belief in his Tadhkiratul Hufadh. And then he said, this is affirmed from Sufyan and the Sheikh. Al-Mukhallas is trustworthy. May Allah have mercy upon them. Now I want to stop here. The first paragraph said what? Read Abdul Fattah, the first paragraph.
This creed is mentioned by the Imam in his remarkable book, Sharh Usul
al-I'tiqad, Ahl Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. This creed is mentioned by the Imam Al-La'laka'i in his remarkable book, and that is a befitting description of his book, Sharh Usul al-I'tiqad, Ahl Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Is one of the greatest books ever written in Islam. In Islam, period. Sharh Usul A'tiqad Ahl Sunnah Al-Jama'ah. It is few volumes. And he compiled, Imam Al-La'laka'i, who died in the 4th or 5th century, he compiled everything about the Aqidah of the Muslims. And then he mentioned specifically the Aqidah which was mentioned by the great Imams of Islam. So he has in there the Aqidah of Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, Ahmad, Bukhari, Sufyan. So this is just one, like you say, it's just 3 pages of that great book. If you can read Arabic, even if you cannot read Arabic, this is one of the books you have to have in your house. Sharh Usul I'tiqad Ahl Sunnah Wal Jama'ah of La'laka'i. It's not in English before you ask me, but it will be great. I'm willing, if you can employ me, I will translate that book. Jokes aside, it's one of the mother books. So we get this book from the Sharh Usul al-I'tiqad of Al-La'laka'i. And then the second paragraph says what? And before that, continue, he says, with his chain of narration leading to Sufyan. So Imam Al-La'laka'i, like I said, he was in the 4th or 5th century. He never met Sufyan, who was in the 3rd century. Or 2nd century, often, because he was born in 97. Okay? So he has his chain to Sufyan. Because you have to prove. How do you prove these words are Sufyan's words? So Imam Al-Laka'i, he has his chain. I took this from so-and-so, from so-and-so, from so-and-so, from so-and-so to Sufyan. And we're going to read the chain, which is called Isnad in Arabic. The Isnad to a Sufyan. Now, read the second paragraph. Al-Hafidh al-Dhahabi also mentioned this belief. Who's al-Dhahabi? All of you should know al-Dhahabi. Not Abu Usama al-Dhahabi. Not Sheikh Abu Usama al-Dhahabi. Not that al-Dhahabi. Not the American one. The real one. The real one. And Imam, Sheikh Abu Usama, he called himself al-Dhahabi after this Imam. Imam al-Dhahabi is one of the outstanding scholars in Islam. He was in the 8th century. But he is known all over the board, meaning hadith, great. History especially, history biographies, one of the greatest, if not the greatest. Tafsir, fiqh, he's up there. Al-Imam al-Dhahabi. His most famous book is what? Siyar A'lamun Nubala, where he compiled biographies from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam all the way to his time. 8th century. Siyar A'lamun Nubala. And also Tadhkiratul Huffaz. It's also a book on biographies. So he says in this book, Tadhkiratul Huffaz, what does he say?
This is mentioned from Sufyan and the Sheikh al-Mukhallas.
He says this is mentioned from Sufyan, there's no doubt. So we're going to mention the isnad of this creed. Why are these things important? Why are we mentioning the chain to Sufyan? Because there's people who come out today and say, no, this is your words, you Salafis, you Wahhabis today. Yes. So you have to prove it to them. Look, these are the words of those great imams of Islam who all of us, we agree on. We agree Bukhari is an imam of Islam. We agree, okay, this is the chain to his words. And he said, this is the Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah. This is the chain to Sufyan al-Thawr, and he said, this is the words of, this is the belief of Ahl Sunnah. This is the chain to Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, and this is what he said. This is why it's important. This is why it's important. Now, read quickly the isnad of this creed.
The isnad of this creed, Muhammad ibn Abdurrahman ibn Abbas ibn Abdurrahman, Abu Tahir al-Baghdadi al-Mukhallas. He is the Sheikh, the Muhaddith, the senior, the truth.
So this is the chain. Sufyan is on top because we're discussing his words. Now we're going from, so who heard from Sufyan? Number one, Muhammad ibn Abdurrahman ibn Abbas. Who heard from Muhammad ibn Abdurrahman ibn Abbas? Number two, who is? Shu'aib ibn Muhammad ibn Rajiyan. Who heard from him? Number three, Ali ibn Harb al-Musili. You see the numbers? You see the numbers in your book, right? Like that. Until it reached to? Huh? Exactly. Naam, read.
He died in the year 2065 Hijri, referred to Sir Alam Nubala. Al-Jarh wa Ta'dil, Tariq Baghdad, Tabaqat al-Hanabila, and Shadrat al-Abu Zahab.
Al-Imam al-Thawri, you are in page 2 now. Page 2, the second paragraph. We're not going to read the Isnad, right? There's no point in that. You'll read yourself since you have that booklet now. He died in the year 196. So how old was he when he died? Huh? Allahu Akbar. Simple math. He was born in 97. Ah, Kaif 64, Habib. He was born in 97. He died in 196. He's 99 years old. Are you sure you're going to university? You're an engineer, by the way. Allahu Akbar. Huh? Now all of us who make mistakes in math sometimes. Simple, he was 97, he died 196, so he's 99 years old. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him in his age. May the mercy of Allah be upon him. And then he gave the references where you want to get the whole biography. And in English, actually, they printed a book, Darussalam, they printed the biography of Sufyan al-Thawri in English. You can get that. As for the text of the creed now, it says, Naam, read.
Muhammad ibn Abdurrahman ibn al-Abbas informed us saying, Abu al-Fadl Shu'aib ibn Muhammad ibn Rajiyah narrated as saying, Ali ibn Harb mostly narrated to us in the year 275 Hijri saying, 257, saying, I heard Shu'aib ibn Harb saying.
So that was the chain. The chain was starting from Imam al-Lakai, from who he narrated, going to Shu'aib ibn Harb. And Shu'aib ibn Harb is one of the great imams of Islam also. Shu'aib ibn Harb is one of the great imams of Islam. He's one of the students of Sufyan al-Thawri. Naam.
I said to Abu Abdullah Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri.
So this creed is between who? It's a dialogue between Shu'aib and Imam Sufyan al-Thawri.
Narrate to me hadith from the Sunnah by which Allah, the mighty and majestic, will benefit me, so that when I stand in front of Allah, the blessed and exalted, and he asks me concerning it, saying, from where did you take this? I would say, oh my Lord, Sufyan al-Thawri narrated this hadith to me, and I took it from him, so that I am saved, and then you are questioned for it.
Subhanallah. Look how they used to talk to each other. He says to him, tell me something, a hadith from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, by which Allah, the Might and Majestic, will benefit me through that. So that when I stand in front of Allah on the Day of Judgment, and He asks me, why do you do this? I will say, oh my Lord, I heard this from Sufyan al-Thawri. So that I can be saved. And you will be the one who's responsible.
So Sufyan said, oh Shu'ayb, this is an assurance, and what other assurance can be better than this?
Tayyib, before we go ahead, what did Shu'ayb ask? He says, narrate to me, tell me from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, words which I can do and hold on to so that I can be saved. And when I stand in front of Allah, I'll say, oh Allah, I was given this by al-Thawri. What we learn here, the most important thing to learn here is, Shu'ayb ibn Harb didn't say, oh Imam Sufyan, tell me what's your opinion on this. You understand? What did he say to him? Narrate to me from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is what we are supposed to do. Like I just said, I mentioned Imam Ahmad's words. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Or today people follow his madhab, the Hanbal. It's one of the greatest imams of hadith. His musnad is the greatest compilation of hadith we have now. He said what? لا تقلدوني. Don't blind follow me. ولا تقلدوا مالك ولا سفيان. Don't blind follow Malik, Imam Malik or Sufyan. Rather you should take from where we took. Where is that? The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And don't forget the setting. We said, where was Imam Sufyan al-Thawri? In Kufa, which is today Iraq. And Kufa was where most of the bid'ah, the innovations, came about. At-tashayyu' wal-rafd, Shi'ism, Rafida ideology came from Kufa. Basra, al-Qadr, speaking about the Qadr, came from Basra. And all other, many of those bid'ahs. So this is what Imam Sufyan al-Thawri is. So Shu'ayb says to him, narrate to me from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you'll be questioned for it. So when I stand in front of Allah and I act by this, I say, oh Allah, Sufyan told me. So you'll be questioned. Now that's a great responsibility. That's a great responsibility. So we say, as Ahl Sunnah, we respect our scholars, but we don't blind follow our scholars. Our scholars, they are what? They are the means. They are the ladder, you know, for us to reach to understanding what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought. The scholars are not the goal. Or the sheikh said, no. If the sheikh said according to the sunnah, yes. If the sheikh said just from his opinion, no. And this is what they taught us. This is what they, Malik, Ahmad, Shafi'i, Thawri, Bukhari, that's what they taught us. Abu Hanifa, that's what they taught us. Tayyib? Okay. So Sufyan replied to Shu'ayb saying what?
In the name of Allah, most merciful, ever merciful.
Before that, he said, oh Shu'ayb, this is an assurance. And then he said to him what? Uktub, write. Write what I'm going to tell you. So don't just sit there. So we always say, we'll come to halakas, we need to come to halakas and read and write. We take down notes. Because that's how we are, human beings. If you just come and listen, by the time you leave, you just leave with 20%, they say. Tomorrow, if you have 2%, Allah alhamdulillah. Tomorrow. So we study through books, right? قَيِّدُ الْعِلْمُ بِالْكِتَابَةِ. And those of you who read Kitab al-Ilm of Sahih al-Bukhari before together, Bukhari is a whole chapter, Kitab al-Ilm, writing knowledge. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to tell people, write knowledge. Uktub li Abi Shah, write for Abu Shah in the hadith. So writing is preservation of knowledge. So Sufyan said to him, write. Don't just listen to me, write. What should he write? Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah. Here we have a good translation of Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. It says what? Most merciful, ever merciful to his believing servants. In most translations of Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, you'll see what? In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. If I ask the most learned of us, what's the meaning of most gracious? It's most merciful. Then the next one is most merciful also. What's the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? Two beautiful names of Allah. What's the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? Naam, Habib.
Ar-Rahman, Yarham al-Ibad. Ar-Rahim, there is no one merciful like him. Up to his level, his rahmah. Or wasi'at. Wasi'at, wa rahmati wasi'at kullu shay.
No, it's opposite. Which one is for the believers? Which one is for everybody? No, opposite. Opposite. Ar-Rahman, alladhi rahmatuhu wasi'at kulla shay. So Allah says in the Quran, wa rahmati wasi'at kulla shay. The one, all of them come from the root word rahma, which means mercy. But Ar-Rahman, he is the one whose mercy is on everything, not everyone. Everything, Allah's mercy is there, and we talked about this last week. Even animals, Allah has put mercy in the hadith you read last week, in the book of heart softeners. Allah, the Prophet said, what? Allah created 100 parts of rahmah, mercy, and He kept 99 with Him, and He only gave one in this world, and that is which we have mercy on each other. So the rahmah of Allah, Ar-Rahman, is the one who's merciful over everything. That is why it is not allowed for someone to call himself Rahman. It's not allowed for a human being to call himself Rahman. Abdul Rahman, yes. Because Rahman is the one whose mercy is on everything. When you call yourself that, that's not befitting, that's lying. Ar-Rahim is who? Like you mentioned, the one whose mercy, He has specific mercy for the believers. So Ar-Rahman is the one whose mercy is on everything, everyone. Ar-Rahim is the one who displays His specific mercy, special mercy for those who believe in Him. And if you read the Quran, you'll see that. وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. He is to the believers, Rahim. What surah is that? تَحِيَّتُهُمْ يَوْمَ الْقَوْنَهُ السَّلَامُ. Surah Al-Ahzab. And he is to the believers Rahim. Okay? Can someone call himself Rahim? We have one here. Huh? Can you call yourself Rahim as your name? The answer is yes. You're merciful to the believers. That's possible. But better is what? Abdul Rahim. But Rahman, no. You see the difference? Yes. So he said, write and start with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So before we go to the creed, this issue always comes about. Should we start Bismillah with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim whenever we give a lecture, whenever we speak, whenever we write a letter? Many of the scholars of Islam, they said yes. And they have proofs for that. One of the proofs is what? That the Quran, every surah starts with the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Another proof is what? In the Quran, Allah mentions the letter which was written by His great prophet, Sulaiman alayhi salam. And He says what? Innahu min Sulaiman wa innahu Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. What surah is that? Surah An-Naml. This letter is from Sulaiman. And it starts with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And when the Prophet ﷺ used to write treaties and letters, he would write Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So they say this is practical proof that if you want to write something, you write with Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. As for the hadith, the Shaykh mentioned, the hadith says, Kullu amrin la yubda'u bihi bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim fahuwa. Then that hadith is weak. All of the muhaddithun, scholars of hadith, agreed. The hadith says, any matter which does not start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, then that matter is not complete. That is not a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they use the proofs though, what we mentioned before. So he said to him, write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. But there is an authentic hadith before we continue for benefit. With the same wording, any matter which is not started with the shahud, then it is not complete. Those are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is an authentic hadith. Kullu amrin, any matter which you start before saying that tashahud, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna muhammadar rasulullah, then that matter, that speech is not complete. So you find the common mistake we have in our masajid. Someone wants to speak, he stands and he says what he heard everybody else saying, Bismillah wa salatu salamu ala rasulillah, and then he speaks. That is good, but that matter is not complete. Bismillah, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna muhammad rasulullah, Allahumma salli ala muhammad wa ala ali muhammad, to the end. Then you speak. And then you speak. And you see, that's how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to start his khutab. Inna alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina min sayyi'ati man yahdillahu wa man yudlil wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Tayyib. So the first point, I would have loved if the translator actually numbered the points of the aqidah, but they did not do that, which is also fine. The first point of the aqidah of Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, he mentioned. He says, read.
The Quran is the word of Allah, it is not created. It is originated from him, and to him it will return. Whoever says other than this is a disbeliever.
He says, Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, القرآن كلام الله منه بدأ وإليه يعود من قال غير هذا فهو كافر. The Quran is the word of Allah, غير مخلوق, it is not created, it came from Allah and it shall return to him. That is our belief of Ahl Sunnah. Whoever says other than this belief, he is not a believer. There's a footnote there, they put, so we're going to read the footnote. Naam.
The Quran is the speech of Allah and his revelation, tanzeel.
The Quran is the speech of Allah and his revelation, tanzeel.
It is not created in whichever manner it may be written or when it is recited. In whatever place it may be recited, whether it's found in the heaven or upon the earth. However it may be preserved, whether written in the Lawh al-Mahfuz, the preserved tablet, or in the copies of the children of the Quranic schools.
It is not created. Whether it is what? In whatever place it might be recited or written. However it is preserved, it is the words of Allah which are not created.
Or in the copies of the children of the Quranic schools, or inscribed on a stone and written on a paper or leaf, whether memorized in the heart or spoken by the tongue. Whoever says other than this, or claims that the Quran in the earth or in the heaven is other than the Quran that which we recite with our tongues, and which we recite in the Masahif, or he believes that in his heart, or he conceals such a belief in his heart, or who professes it with his tongue, and then is a disbeliever, whose blood and wealth is lawful, and who is free from Allah, and Allah is free from him, as has been said by At-Tabari in his Sahih Sunnah.
Sahih Sunnah. This was the translator he quoted from Imam Abu Ja'far ibn Jarir At-Tabari, one of the great Imams of Islam also, and one of the people who had their own madhab. People used to follow him. The greatest mufassir of the Quran. The greatest tafsir of the Quran is the book of Ibn Jarir At-Tabari. He wrote a nice book on Aqidah also called Sarih Sunnah, the clear Sunnah. These are his words. Basically, he is saying, we Ahlus Sunnah, we believe the Quran is the speech of Allah. It is not created. Those are two points. We'll go one by one. One by one. What do we mean the Quran is the speech of Allah? Does it mean Allah speaks? I'm asking you actually. I'm asking. Does it mean Allah speaks? Huh? You said yes? Prove it. Ahsant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah 2, A'raf, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah spoke to Musa a speech. Another proof from the Quran that Allah speaks. Give me the proof in the Quran, because someone might say, this is your words. Yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Al-Baqarah, وَقَالَ يَا آدَمُ, and the Lord said, O Adam, أُسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ, you and your wife stay here in paradise. Another proof that Allah speaks. You'll bring 500 verses maybe of the Quran. Huh? وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ, and when your Lord say to the angels, أُسْجُدُوا لِآدَمُ, prostrate to Adam. And subhanAllah, the amazing thing about this is that Allah used in the Quran all kinds of verbs which denote speech. The most famous verb which denotes speech in Arabic is what? قَالَ يَقُولُ. Okay? He said, or he is saying, past and present. Okay? What are other verbs which denote speech? Allah mentions about himself, An-Nida. What is An-Nida? To speak, calling someone with a high voice. What does Allah say about himself? إِذْ نَادَ رَبُّكَ. إِذْ نَادَ رَبُّكَ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ. Tua, when your Lord called Musa in the sacred valley of Tua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he used the word kallama, spoke. Wa kallama Allahu Musa taklima. Wa idh yaqulu rabbuk. All of these to show there's no doubt Allah speaks. Yes, Allah speaks. But just like all the other attributes, descriptions of Allah, we say what? Laysa kamithlihi shay'un. There's no example, similitude of Allah. How does Allah speak? We don't know how Allah speaks. You understand? That is what we believe as Ahlus Sunnah. And that is the belief of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the belief of Al-Thawri. And we quote it from Ibn Jirir al-Tabari. And you've read Abu Hanifa and Malik and Shafi and Ahmad. And all of them said the same thing. Allah speaks. How does he speak? Allah knows. We don't know. And the Quran is the speech of Allah. The Quran is the speech of Allah. Okay, so we mentioned many proofs that Allah speaks. Mention some proofs from the Quran that the Quran is the speech of Allah. It says, علم القرآن. He taught the Quran. So it doesn't really mention the word speech or spoke, or the Quran is the speech of Allah. Inna anzalnahu, we revealed it. It doesn't really mention that Allah spoke the Quran. We want clear proof.
Sorry, what about علمه شديد القوة? It's God, he teach.
Jibreel was taught the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it doesn't mention speech clearly. We want clear speech. I see several hufadh of the Quran. Let me give you a clue. Surah At-Tawbah. First page. At the bottom there. Yeah, that's where that ayah is. Hasant. Surah At-Tawbah. Just chapter number 9, verse number 6. Allah says, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَ. Allah says, and if one of the mushrikeen, one of the disbelievers, استجارك, he wants to seek refuge with you. He says, give me refuge as a Muslim. You are a Muslim, I'm not a Muslim, so I want to come to your land. Give me refuge. So you give him refuge. You say, okay, this one is under my protection. فَأَجِرْهُ, give him protection. Why? Allah says, why? حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ, so he can hear كَلَامَ اللَّهِ, the speech of Allah. What is the speech of Allah? The Quran, meaning give him protection so you can give him da'wah. Tell him this is the message of Allah. After that, ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَا, then take him to a safe place and you are him are done. So Allah spoke this Quran. As for the verses which say it is tanzil, it is revelation from Allah, then those are so many. Those are so many. So the Quran is the speech of Allah. It is not created. What does that mean, it is not created? Why do we say it is not created? Because like we just said, the speech of Allah is one of his attributes. And Allah, is he created or he is the creator? He is the creator, and whatever is part of him is not created, obviously. You understand? So his speech is not created. His actions are not created. He is the creator. He is the creator. It is not created. Why do they put this in the books of Aqidah? Why Sufyan al-Thawri of all the points he studied with this one? Because this is one of the main deviations which happened in this ummah. People who came and they said, no, the Quran is not the speech of Allah. Allah created this and just brought it. Why they said this? Because they tried to bring philosophy into the religion. So in philosophy, when you think like that, you don't think with submission. Allah said that is enough. They say, how can Allah speak? We speak. So if Allah speaks, it means what? He is like us. Then we are resembling Allah. That is kufr. So we say, no, no, he doesn't speak. He just created this Quran. What we have is the meanings of Allah's words, not Allah's words. Philosophy now. They ran away from a sin and they fell into a sin. They ran away from resembling Allah and they fell into a bigger sin, which is what? Rejecting Allah's verses. Allah says, I speak. Who are you to say no? You don't speak. How do we know Allah? This is an important question. I want you today, if you go home, go ask your wife and your children. How do we know Allah? It's a simple question, yet many people cannot answer. You believe in Allah, all of you? Huh? All of you believe in Allah? You're Muslims here. Unless there's a Jew hiding here or a Christian or atheist and you're just a spy. Today I mentioned about spies in the khutbah. There's a brother who said, Sheikh, you need to explain the topic more. I like it. I said, okay. We believe in Allah. How do we know Allah? Have you seen Allah? And whoever claims this is Allah is a kafir. Does Allah, you know, does Allah speak to you or me? No. Allah only spoke to his prophets. So how do we know Allah? Through his prophet. What Allah told his prophet, tell my slaves this is who I am. And that is through his Quran and the sunnah of the prophet. So we only know Allah through what he described himself with. And that is the meaning we read every day in Ayatul Kursi. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ, meaning, and they, the human beings, cannot comprehend anything of Allah's knowledge except what Allah wants. What Allah wants us to know about him, that's what we know. You understand? So Allah describes himself in the Quran, says, I know everything. I hear everything. I am al-Basir. I see everything. I'm al-Sami'. I hear everything. I'm al-Qahir. وهو القاهر فوق عبادي, I'm the one who subdues everyone. I'm the creator of everything. I'm the one who bestows for some people male children, some people female. Some people are giving male and female. Some people I don't give them children. I'm the only one who saves the one who is in trouble. I'm the one who feeds you. And me and you, what is our duty? You say what? Sami'na ata'na. This is who you are, O Allah. We believe. So when people took this and they said, oh, but we speak also. So we can say Allah speaks. Already the shaitan is playing with you. Allah said and described himself with all these attributes, but he also said in the Quran what? Laysa kamithlihi shay'un. He does not have an example. There's no similitude to him. And the subhanAllah, the amazing thing about that verse, which is Surah Al-Shu'ara, Allah says, Laysa kamithlihi shay'un. He has no example, no similitude, nothing like him. How does Allah end the verse? Wa huwa as-sami'ul basir. And he is the all-hearing, the all-seeing. So he's the all-hearing, yet there's no one who resembles him. To make it more simple, because those people, they act like they love Allah more than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said Allah sees and hears. They say, how can you resemble Allah to us? Today, if I asked you, who has a pet cat in his house here? Cat. Does your cat hear or not? It hears. Right or wrong? If I say you today, Khalid, you hear. Am I offending you because I'm resembling you to the cat? See, it's funny, right? No, I'm not resembling you. Why? Because the cat hears in its capacity as an animal. And you are a human being, you hear in your capacity as a human being. It's different. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears, and He is the perfect, all majestic hearing. We don't even know how it is. You understand? It doesn't necessarily mean you're resembling Allah. This is important because many people deviated in this. The chapter of Allah's attributes and names. We believe in them as they came, without asking how they are, because we don't know Allah unless He tells us how He is. And we don't resemble Allah's attributes with anything. And do not let the shaitan play with you. So the Quran is the word of Allah. It is not created. And it originated from Him, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gave the Quran to Jibreel, and Jibreel would come and give it to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allamahu shadidul quwa. Whoever says other than this, he is not a Muslim. Someone may find this harsh. I guarantee you, go open any book of Aqidah of any of these great Imams of Islam, and they all say the same thing. Whoever says other than this, he is a kafir, is not a Muslim. All of them. Ahmad, Abu Hanifa. In fact, Abu Hanifa was more harsh. Shafi, all of them, because this is the aqidah of Ahl Sunnah. Why? We just proved it from the Quran. So many verses from the Quran. So we believe the Quran is the word of Allah. It is not created. From Him it came, as we know, and it shall return to Him. What does that mean? It shall return to Him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "La taqumu sa'a," the final hour will not come, except that on the earth, no one will say Allah, Allah. Leave the Quran. Nobody even knows La ilaha illallah. The Quran will be taken away. That's the end of times. The end, meaning that's it, the end. Because just before the end, Allah will send a wind which will grab all the believers. Because those who are alive at the end, those are the worst people. As in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reported by Malik in his Muwatta, the worst people, he said, the worst people are those who take graves as places of worship. Mazar, Adriha. And the people will be alive when the hour comes. All the believers will be taken away. So we believe the Quran is the words of Allah. It is not created. So we'll continue reading the footnotes. We have 2 minutes, because it's a long footnote they put. This is the end of page 2. We are right at the bottom of page 2, and then we're going to go continue on page 3, the footnote. Now, read.
Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said about the verse, an Arabic Quran without any crookedness, Surah Zumar, not created, Sharh Usul al-Atiqad.
Meaning Ibn Abbas, when he was doing the tafsir of this verse in Surah Al-Zumar, Quran an Arabiyan ghayra dhi, it's an Arabic Quran with no crookedness. He said, what does no crookedness mean? He says, not created. And this is reported by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari in his tafsir. Naam.
Al-Malakai said, Sa'id ibn Nasir said, I heard Ibn Uyayna saying, what does this sound, meaning Bishr al-Marisi say? They said, oh, Abu Muhammad ibn Abu Imran, he says the Quran is created. So he replied, he has lied. Allah the Mighty and Majestic said, surely he is the creator.
He is the creation.
His is the creation, khalq and the command, amr, al-araf. So the creation in the creation of Allah and the command, amr, is the Quran.
This is narration from Sufyan ibn Uyayna, who's one of the students of Al-Thawri, one of the great imams of Islam. He said to them, what does this man, Bishr al-Maris? Bishr al-Maris is one of the great deviants who brought this statement that the Quran is created. They said, he says the Quran is created. He said, Kadhab, he's lying. Why is he lying? The Quran proves him wrong. Because Allah says in Surah Al-A'raf, Ala lahu al-khalqu wal-amr. He's Allah, listen carefully. Allah says, Ala lahu al-khalqu wal-amr. He's is the creation and the command. How many things are there? Two, creation and command. So Allah mentioned the creation, which is all the creation. And then His is the command, the Quran. So the Quran is not the creation. It's two different things. Meaning Allah is the one who created and Allah is the one who commands the creation. How does Allah command the creation? Through the Quran. So the Quran is not the creation. You understand? Naam.
And Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal and Nu'aym ibn Muhammad, Muhammad ibn Yahya, al-Dihli, Abdus-Salam.
Basically, because it's time for Isha, he mentioned all these Imams of the Salaf, the Imams of Islam, we need to know them. They all said the same thing. And like I told you, I guarantee you, any book of Aqeedah of Ahl Sunnah of these Imams you open, you'll find this. For those of you, we studied the Aqeedah of Imam Bukhari before together, he mentioned this. We studied Usul Sunnah of Imam Ahmad, he mentioned this. We studied what? Al-Wasitiyya, among other these brothers, he mentioned that. We studied, what was other? The book of the Creed of the Four Imams, mentioning Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, Malik, and Ahmad, they all mentioned this. The Quran is the word of Allah, it's not created. We studied Al-Tahawiyya of Imam Abu Ja'far Al-Tahawi, he mentioned this. And then he mentions here Imam Ahmad and Nu'aym bin Hamad and Muhammad bin Yahya al-Dihli, Abdul Salam bin Asim al-Razi, Ahmad bin Sinan al-Wasiti, Abu Hatim al-Razi. We studied with Sheikh Hamad al-Tuwajiri when he came, the Aqeedah of the two Razis. He mentioned that. This is the Aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah. It has no doubt. We're going to take a break and we'll continue after Salatul Isha, inshallah. Salam. Subhanakallah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Hayya 'ala as-salah. Hayya 'ala as-salah.
أنا روح توضع خليك سند
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استوى الصديم وتراص تبين الصديم وانتبه 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 استموا واستقيموا وتراصوا اعتدلوا الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا فلهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير. إن بطش ربك لشديد إنه هو يبدئ ويعيد وهو الغفور الودود ذو العرش المجيد فعال لما يريد. هل أتاك حديث الجنود فرعون وثمود بل الذين كفروا في تكذيب والله من ورائهم محيط بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. إن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب والمشركين في نار جهنم خالدين فيها أولئك هم شر البرية إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات أولئك هم خير البرية جزاؤهم عند ربهم جنات عدن تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها أبدا رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه ذلك لمن خشي ربه. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، the second point الإمام الثوري he mentioned, he says page number 3. Now I'm read. Read Abdul Fattah.
Ali ibn Hassan.
La. Leave the footnote. We just continue now on the top of page 3.
An iman consists of speech, action, and intention. It increases and decreases. It increases with acts of obedience, and it decreases with acts of disobedience. No speech is accepted except with action, and no speech and action are accepted except with intention, and no speech. Action and intention are accepted unless they agree with the Sunnah. Shu'aib said, I said, O Abu Abdullah, Abu Abdullah, and what is the agreement with the Sunnah? He said, giving precedence to the two sheikhs, Abu Bakr and Umar, may Allah be pleased with them both. O Shu'aib, what you have written would not benefit you until you put Uthman and Ali ahead of those who came after them.
O Shu'aib, Tayyib. So the second point Imam al-Thawri, he mentioned, he says, وَالْإِيمَانُ قَوْلٌ وَعَمَلٌ وَنِيَّةٌ. And Iman, we're on the top of page 3. And Iman consists of speech, action, and intention. يَزِيدُ وَيَنْقُسْ. And Iman, it increases and decreases. يَزِيدُ بِالطَّاعَةِ. It increases with acts of obedience, obeying Allah. وَيَنْقُسُ بِالْمَعَصِيَةِ. And it decreases by disobeying Allah. وَعَلَمْ. And know that no speech is accepted except with action, and no speech and action are accepted without the intention, and no speech nor action nor intention are accepted unless they agree to the Sunnah. Shu'aib said, oh Abu Abdullah, that is the kunya of al-Thawri. What do you mean accept if they agree with the Sunnah? And he says now, what is the Sunnah? He says what? Look, what does he say? Now top of page four, he says what? Giving precedence to the two sheikhs, Abu Bakr and Umar. That is the Sunnah for them. And oh Shu'aib, you should know, whatever you have written from me now, it will not benefit you until you put Uthman and Ali ahead of those who came after them. And then he'll say again, oh Shu'aib, and then again. So this point is called the point about Iman. What do Ahl Sunnah hold as their creed, their aqidah, in the matter of the topic of Iman? Al-Iman meaning belief. Sometimes we say Islam. What is Islam? What is Iman? According to the definition of Ahlul Sunnah, Iman or Islam is what? Belief in the heart. And Imam al-Thawri here mentioned it as intention. Beliefs in the heart, that is part of Iman. What you believe about Allah, that is part of Iman. Things in the heart. Statements of the tongue, that is part of Iman. And the most important of that is what? La ilaha illallah. Because the belief you have in the heart, if you don't say the shahada, it doesn't benefit you. And then there's the actions of actually proving the Iman inside. The actions and the statements and the belief, this is Iman according to Ahlul Sunnah. If you took any of those out from the definition of Iman, then you're not from the Ahl Sunnah. And this is also, you have to understand something. I didn't mention this, and you have to forgive me for that. This is a very, like we see, it's a very small book in Aqidah. Imam al-Thawri, he mentioned the basics of the Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah. Like you won't see here him talking about, we believe there's a Dajjal who's going to come out, believe in the Mahdi, that Isa ibn Maryam is going to come back, he's not dead. We believe in the matters of the Day of Judgment. He didn't talk about any of those, Adhab al-Qabr, in the punishment of the grave. He mentioned the core beliefs of Ahl Sunnah, that is the matter of the Quran. The Quran is the words of Allah, it's not created. Number two is Iman. Whoever goes against this belief is not considered from those who follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can consider him from the Ahl Sunnah in the general definition of Ahl Sunnah, which is what? You're not Shia, so you're Sunnah. That's the general definition of Ahl Sunnah. But Ahl Sunnah, meaning those who are following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in belief before actions. Believe first. No. So we believe Iman, Islam is what? Belief in the heart, statements of the tongue, and action of the limbs. If you take any of those out from your definition of Iman, then you're not on the right path. So we'll go one by one. We'll start with the actions. People who say Iman is enough for you to believe and to say the Shahada. If you do that, you are a complete believer. Even if you never even made one sajda in your life, and you are the worst criminal, you do every sin, morning, day, evening. They say you're a believer, because actions are not part of Iman. They're good, but not an essential part of Iman. I think even a Muslim who doesn't have knowledge will say, come on, are you kidding me? So I can be the worst criminal, riba, zina, killing, raping, destroy the Kaaba, inshallah. Yet I'm a complete believer. I'm like Abu Bakr and Umar. That doesn't make sense, does it? It doesn't make sense. And that is wrong, obviously, because actions are part of Iman. That is why Allah, when he describes the believers, he doesn't just describe them with what? Belief in the heart. He describes them with what? Belief in the heart and actions. Inna alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat. Those who believe and do good actions. So you understand. And those are the people called the Murji'a. The Murji'a, they took actions out of Iman. Say actions are good, but you know they're not part of Iman. The next one, statement. Those who say Iman is just enough if it's in the heart. You don't even have to say anything. Can you agree to that, Abu Abdurrahman? Because that will mean what? Yeah, that's what they say. You don't have to say the Shahada. Iman, belief, tasdiq, just believing in the heart. So you know this is the truth. That's enough for you. That is not correct. Why is it not correct? The proof. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says what? Umirtu an uqatil an-nas hatta yaqulu la ilaha illallah. I was brought to fight the people until they say la ilaha illallah. You're excused if you can't say, you know, you don't speak. And someone who doesn't speak in proper English, he's called dumb. The actual meaning of the word dumb is someone who can't speak. We use it today to mean someone who's weak-minded. You understand? Or we call him mute also, someone who can't speak. He doesn't have to say the Shahada. Why? Because he can't. So for him, just belief is enough. But someone who can say the Shahada, we don't say that Iman is just belief in the heart. Because that also means what? Iblis is Iman, is a mu'min. Iblis, Shaitan, the devil, he's a believer also, right or wrong? Why? What is the proof? Does Iblis know that Allah is the one true God? What is your proof? You talk to him? Okay, you better not talk to him. What is the proof from the Quran? When Iblis was told, you are cursed. He said what? قَالَ فَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَأُغْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. He said, I swear by your might, I'm going to try these sons of Adam, I'm going to take all of them away from the Sirat al-Mustaqim. He knows Allah is the only God. That's why he swears by Allah. You understand? He swears by Allah. Yeah. After you disobey Allah, especially with this happened in the Battle of Badr, when he took the disbelieving Quraysh, said, let's go and fight them. When he saw the angels coming down, he started running. Said, Inni akhafu Allah. I fear Allah. So also, we can give another example. Fir'aun will be a believer. Fir'aun and his group, Haman and Qarun and the others. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about them. Another proof from the Quran. Allah says about what? About Fir'aun and Haman, his minister. وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. And they rejected the message which came with Musa alayhi salam, but وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ. Their souls had yaqeen. This is the truth. Why did they refuse it? Allah says, ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. Because they're people of ظُلْم, oppressors, and they can't come down and be at the same level as Musa. عُلُوًا, we are the leaders. No, we can't be like you. So they knew this was the truth. Yet they fought it. You understand? So they're not Muslims. Just because you know in the heart, you're not a Muslim. You don't have iman unless you say the shahada. Another example is the uncle of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Talib. Abu Talib knew this is the truth. He says what? Lawla madhamma. If it was not for the fact these other Quraysh, they're going to speak bad about me, I would accept this religion because I know Deen Muhammad, the religion of Muhammad is the truth. But he only refused. Why? Because he doesn't want Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl to speak against him. So when they came, when he was dying, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim. He said, Ya Am, qul la ilaha illallah. Say la ilaha illallah. He said, what? Say la ilaha illallah. Kalimatun hajju bika biha indallah. If you say la ilaha illallah, then I'll stand in front of Allah and say, oh Allah, my uncle, he said la ilaha illallah. On the other side of the bed was Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Umayyah bin Khalaf. And they say to him, atarghabu amillati Abdul Muttalib? You're going to leave the religion of your father. And the Prophet ﷺ say, la ilaha illallah. He says, you're going to leave the religion of your father. فَكَانَ آخِرُ قَوْلِهِ. This last statement, he said what? عَلَى مِلَّةِ عَبْدِ الْمُتَّلِبِ. I am follow the religion of my father. And the Prophet ﷺ cried and he became, that was called the عَامُ الْحُزْن, the year of sadness, because he lost Khadija also that year. And Abu Talib, as you know, he used to protect the Prophet ﷺ. So he wanted good for him. And Allah revealed the verse, he said what? إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتِ. You don't guide who you want. When he died, Ali ibn Abi Talib came, said, my father died. He says what to him? Idhab fawari abaka al-kafir. Go and bury your father who's a kafir. He knew inside. He used to say those lines of poetry. If it is not for the blame of the blamers, I would accept the deen of Muhammad. So the point here is what? Iman, according to Ahl Sunnah, is what? Belief in the heart, iman bil qalb, tasdiqun bil lisan, testifying by the tongue, wal amalu bil jawarih, and to act. So all the beliefs you hold in your heart, they are part of iman. Believing that Allah, he is al-hayyul qayyum, the one who takes care of everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is rabbul alamin. Knowing that is iman. Believing that is iman. And then speaking good words, la ilaha illallah is the top of them. Dhikr, Quran, commanding good, forbidding evil, making dua. These are all statements of the tongue, part of iman. And actions of the limbs, sitting in a halaqah like this, praying salah, you know, all of these are iman. You don't take any of them out. And we answered that question last Sunday here, when someone asked what is the explanation of the hadith when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, al-imanu bidu'na sab'una shu'ba. In Bukhari and Muslim. And that is the narration of Muslim. That iman is 70 odd branches. 73, 74 branches. What did the Prophet ﷺ say now? We're talking about iman. The Prophet ﷺ says, iman, it has 70 something branches. He said, a'laha, the highest of it is what? La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah is what though? A statement. Yet he says, this is iman. Iman has 70 branches. The highest of them, the best, is what? A statement. And we know that statement won't benefit you unless you have belief in the heart of it. Otherwise, you'll be a munafiq. You say, I'm a Muslim, you're not a Muslim. And then he said, adnaha, the lowest part of iman from the 70 branches is what? Imatatul adha anit tariq. To remove something harmful from the road which people pass. What is that? Belief in the heart? It's an action of the limbs. Yet that is iman. So that is iman. Iman, things are in the heart. the tongue and the limbs. After you know that, we should also know something about Iman. The Aqeed of Ahl Sunnah, we believe that Al-Iman yazid wa yanqus. Iman increases and decreases. He says, Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, to explain, yazidu bit-ta'at. It increases by being obedient to Allah. We just prayed right now. If you prayed properly, your Iman increased. We are sitting in a halakha, remembering Allah and learning His religion. Our Iman is increasing automatically if the intention is good. If you and it decreases by disobeying Allah, whatever sin you do, your Iman goes down. What is the proof of this? Because Sufyan al-Thawri said it? I'm asking first before you answer me. What is the proof? Because Sufyan al-Thawri said it, so it's our religion now? No. Because Abu Hanifa said it? No. Because Shafi'i said it? No. What is the proof? Either from the Quran or the Hadith, the Sahih Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you have proof in the Quran, Sheikh, that Iman increases and decreases? Surah Al-Anfal, what does it say? Surah Al-Anfal, verse number 2. Allah says, Surah Al-Anfal is chapter number what? What number is it as a surah in the Quran? 8, very good. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ. The true believers are those. إِذَا ذُكِّرَ اللَّهُ. When Allah is mentioned, وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Their hearts shake. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ. And when His verses are recited to them, زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. Those verses, they increase them in Iman. Another one from the Quran. قَالُوا أَيُّكُمْ زَادَتْهُ هَذِهِ. Surah Tawbah, last page. Huh? Yes, last page. Yeah. Last page. 3-4 hours before you end Surah Tawbah. The hypocrites, because Surah Tawbah is called the Surah of Exposing. Because then they were exposed, the hypocrites. It's after one of the last surahs to be revealed. Surah Tawbah. And when Allah says in this verse, the meaning of it, and when a verse is revealed to you believers, the hypocrites speak to themselves saying what? Making fun. أَيُّكُمْ زَادَتْهُمْ هَذِهِ إِيمَانًا. Who amongst you, this one increased in Iman, this new verse or this new surah? They're making fun. Allah replies saying what? فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. As for those who had real Iman, فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. Then their Iman increased. That's another proof. And so many other verses in the Quran showing that Iman increases and decreases. And all of us, I think, we have felt it, especially Ramadan, or when you go for Umrah or Hajj. Your Iman increases. Now. And then he says, Imam Sufyan al-Thawri, before we finish, he says, and no speech is accepted without action. And no action, no speech and action are accepted without intention, as we know that. And no speech, action, and intention. So all of this Iman of yours, they're not accepted unless they agree with the Sunnah. Whatever you do in Islam is not accepted unless it agrees in this with the Sunnah. That's what he says, Sufyan al-Thawri. Shu'aybi said, so I asked him, O Abu Abdullah, what do you mean, unless it agrees with the Sunnah? What does that mean? And then he explains what it means. He says, top of page 4 now. He said, what is the Sunnah? See, most of us, we have learned, you say, none of your actions will be accepted unless they conform to the Sunnah. And if you asked, what does that mean? You'll say what? You'll say, do them according to how? The Prophet ﷺ did them, right? That's not how they define the Sunnah. How did he define the Sunnah? What does he say there on top? Read. He said what? Giving precedence to Abu Bakr and Umar, the two sheikhs. That is the Sunnah. That is the sunnah to them. That is the sunnah. Because if you don't give precedence to Abu Bakr and Umar, you can never follow the Prophet. You can never follow the Prophet. Give precedence to the two sheikhs, Abu Bakr and Umar. And that is the sunnah. And subhanAllah, all these imams of Islam, the second generation, third generation, this is how they understood the word sunnah. The word sunnah to them did not mean two rak'ahs you pray after Isha. This is a newer definition which came in the 6th, 7th, 8th century. The fuqaha, scholars of fiqh, they used to say for the nawafil, they're called nawafil, voluntary prayers, they call them sunnah. Meaning if you do them, it's good. If you don't do them, it's okay. Before though, the word sunnah meant to them what? The correct belief in Islam. That's why there's a list of 10, 12, 15 books which are called something sunnah. And if you read, it doesn't talk about two rak'ahs after Fajr or before Fajr, no. They talk about beliefs of the Muslim. Let me give an example. We just read in the footnote that the Quran is not created, it is Allah's word. We read the translator quoted from who? Al-Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. From his book, which is called what we said? Swarih al-Sunnah. The clear sunnah. It's only a book about Aqidah. Sheikh, I think it's Ziyad al-Abadi. When he came 5 years ago, Quran Sunnah, he explained that book, Sarih al-Sunnah. If I'm not wrong. Or he verified that book, it's printed. Sarih al-Sunnah is all about the Aqidah. Let me give you a better example which relates directly to this one. Sufyan al-Thawri is asked, okay, no actions are accepted except by the Sunnah. What is the Sunnah? It says to give precedence to the two sheikhs, Abu Bakr and Umar. Al-Imam, the Imam of the Sunnah, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, his famous book of Aqidah is called what? Usul al-Sunnah. The foundations of the Sunnah. That's what it's called. It's called the foundations of the Sunnah. You know the first point he mentioned? He said, Usul al-Sunnah indana, the principles of the Sunnah with us. Number one, التمسك بما كان عليه أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم والاقتداء بهم is to hold on to what the companions of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم they used to do and to follow them. That is the foundation of the Sunnah for us. So why do they say this though? Why does Al-Thawri say this? Why did Ahmed say that? Why? Is there proof for that? Is there proof for that? Hassan, the hadith of Irbad bin Sariyah. Huh? When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what? Alaykum bi sunnati, follow my sunnah. Wa sunnati al-khulafai al-rashidina bin ba'di. And the sunnah of the four righteous caliphs after me. Okay, that mentions four of them. I want the one which is very clear, Abu Bakr and Umar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, iqtadu billadhaini min ba'dihi. Follow these two people after me, Abu Bakr and Umar. Clear and simple. Follow these two people after me, Abu Bakr and Umar. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about them, Abu Bakr and Umar to Islam is like hearing and seeing to a human being. Hearing and seeing are two of the most important faculties of yours. That is Abu Bakr and Umar to Islam. And if you start talking about Abu Bakr and Umar, we'll go all night long. Ali ibn Abi Talib said what? How many times I used to hear the Prophet saying what? Kharajtu ana Abu Bakr and Umar. Me and Abu Bakr and Umar we went. Me and Abu Bakr and Umar we came. Me and Abu Bakr and Umar we did that and that and that. Those are the two ministers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then that is the sunnah. And if you don't give them precedence, you're never on the sunnah. You're never on the sunnah. And that means what? Loving them, and following their way. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, Iqtadaw, follow these two after me. Because they never did something the Prophet ﷺ never did. And these used to be their words. Umar used to say that, I will never do something the Prophet ﷺ never did. You know the famous story of? In Sahih Muslim. When Umar went in, when he was doing Umrah or Hajj, and then he went and kissed the black stone, Hajar al-Aswad. He said what? Inni a'lamu annaki hajara. I know you're just a stone. Was Umar talking to a stone? No, he was teaching those who were with him. I know you're just a stone. La tanfa' wa la tadur. You don't benefit, you don't harm. Walawla, if it was not anni ra'aytu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yuqabbiluk, that I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kissing you, I'll never kiss you. That is Islam. So when you see the Imam saying, what is the Sunnah? Give precedence to Abu Bakr and Umar. Meaning, yes, every Muslim will say, yeah, we love the Prophet, we follow the Prophet. Beware. That is easy to say. Do they follow Abu Bakr and Umar? Then they're on the Sunnah. Otherwise, they're not on the Sunnah. Otherwise, they're not on the Sunnah. And there's two groups about this. There's people who don't know. They just say whatever they hear. They think, no, no, I'm smart enough. I have a PhD. I can decide what is good, what is not in Islam. Or they're those who are infected with beliefs of the Shia to Rafida. There's two types of people. But any Muslim, you pick an 85-year-old grandmother in Azerbaijan or Pakistan or any other place where the Muslims live, Syria, Saudi Arabia, Somalia, they'll tell Abu Bakr and Umar. This is from what? The basics of the religion. And the Tabi'un, they used to say what? We used to be taught to love Abu Bakr and Umar just like we used to be taught the Quran. How many teach our children that? We used to be taught to love Abu Bakr and Umar just like we used to be taught the Quran. And Abu Bakr and Umar, you can do studies on them. The kuffar do studies on Umar especially. Because they are complete personalities. I've mentioned, you've heard me saying this before. If you want to know complete personality, and they learned that from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, study Abu Bakr and Umar. What do I mean? If I mention Abu Bakr, what comes to your mind? His personality, what comes to your mind? Kindness, soft, gentle. Right or wrong? If I mention Umar, what comes to your mind? Don't say Sheikh Abdul Aziz. Don't say that. Tough. Okay, we'll start with Abu Bakr. Yet in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, because when the Prophet ﷺ died, there's huge groups of the Arabs. They left Islam. They say the Prophet died, we're no longer Muslim. And there's huge groups of people who say, we won't pay zakah anymore. What did Abu Bakr do? He came to Umar and said what? I'm going to fight all of them. And Umar said, how are you going to fight people? They say, la ilaha illallah. He said, I'm going to fight anyone who separates between as-salah and zakah. Umar, well, you know what? Umar is the tough one. He's the one trying to convince Abu Bakr not to fight. Abu Bakr says, I'm going to fight all of them. Wallahi law mana'uni iqalan. If they prevent a rope you tie on an animal, it's called iqal. That's why they name the rope they tie on the hell iqal also. If that is of zakah and they don't give it, I'm going to fight them for that. Abu Bakr was soft though. This is the point. The complete personality, there's times to be soft, there's times to be tough. And that was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like I said, they learned from the best, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Until Umar said, حَتَّ رَأَيْتُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ إِنْ شَرَحَ صَدْرَ أَبُو بَكْرَ. I saw that Allah has opened his heart and I knew this was the truth. We have to fight. Umar, we know him as tough. Yet, when he used to stand to lead Salah, again in Sahih Muslim, those who were praying with him could not hear him because of his crying. Aisha says this. Said Aisha or someone else, you cannot hear him. Umar, one time he passed by a place and he heard someone reciting the verse which says, وَالتُّورِ وَكِتَابِ مَسْتُورِ فِي رَقٍ مَنْشُورِ وَالْبَيْتِ الْمَعْمُورِ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ وَالسَّقْفِ الْمَرْفُوعِ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ وَالْبَحْرِ الْمَسْجُورِ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ لَوَاقِعَ. The punishment of your Lord is going to happen. He went home and he was sick because of that verse for 3 days. And people are visiting him. What is wrong with you? He says, I'm sick. Complete personalities. That's my point. You understand? That's how we're supposed to be. They learned from who? The greatest personality, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they described him as what? كان أشد حياء من البكر في حجرها أو في خدرها. He was more shy than a virgin girl who never comes out outside. That's how shy he was. And his hands were softer than any silk you can touch. Yet Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he says, لما اشتد البأس, when we're fighting and the war was tough, كنا نتقي به, all of us will be behind him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of us, Ali says that, Ali is one of the greatest warriors. Ali, Abu Bakr, Umar, Hamza, they'll all be behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Complete personality. It's times to be tough, it's times you're soft. And of course, there's always the dominant character. So that's why we say Umar is tough and Abu Bakr is soft. Yet they're the greatest warriors. And Umar radiallahu anhu used to say, Alhamdulillah alladhi ja'ala fi qalbi rahmatan lahum. Alhamdulillah alladhi ja'ala fi qulubihim ru'batan li. I thank Allah who put in their hearts the fear of me, they fear me. But I thank Allah who put so much mercy in my heart for them. Complete personalities. That is the point. Okay? So coming back, this is the meaning of the words of Sufyan al-Thawri. The sunnah is to follow Abu Bakr and Umar. Is to follow Abu Bakr and Umar. And then he said, O Shu'aib, what you have written will not benefit you until you put Uthman and Ali ahead of those who came after them. After Abu Bakr and Umar comes Uthman and then Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. Now there's 2 points here, I want you to listen carefully. In terms of the Khilafah, leadership, who was the Khalifa of the Muslims? There's no doubt with Ahl Sunnah, it was Abu Bakr and then Umar and then Uthman and then Ali. And all of them agreed on that. When I say all of them themselves. When Abu Bakr was the Khalifa, everybody agreed to that. When Umar was the Khalifa, everybody agreed to that. When Uthman was the Khalifa, everybody agreed to that. When Ali was the Khalifa, everybody agreed to that. But that is the Khilafa. And whoever says otherwise, he is not on the Sunnah. And that is like that. The Shia to Rafida will tell you, no, Ali was supposed to be number one. Or the Khawarij, who will tell you what? Yes, Abu Bakr and Umar, but Uthman and Ali, they were kafir also. The Khawarij, they meet with the Shia there. You have to know that. That's why they killed Uthman. Who do you think killed Uthman? That's why they killed Ali. Who do you think killed Ali? Okay? They meet with the Shia there. These ones make takfir of Uthman and Ali, and the Shia make takfir of Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman, and the rest of the Sahaba. So that is in terms of Khilafa, we Ahlul Sunnah will say Abu Bakr, thumma Umar, thumma Uthman, thumma Ali. In terms of excellence though, as a Muslim, who was better? Abu Bakr, and then Umar, and then it is either Uthman or Ali. It is either Uthman or Ali. And this is a statement within Ahlul Sunnah. So if you find someone who tell you Ali was better than Uthman as a person, not in terms of Khilafah, it could be. It's a statement of Ahlul Sunnah. But of course, what has become established is that we go in the same order as the Khilafah. What has become established is we know that, like Imam Sufyan puts it here clearly, those two, they're untouchable. Abu Bakr and Umar, nobody comes close. And then there's Uthman and Ali. And those two, nobody else comes close to them. Nobody comes close to Uthman and Ali. So Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, Sa'id bin Zayd, Abdurrahman bin Auf, Talha bin Ubaidullah, Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah, they don't come close to any of this. And like I mentioned here on Sunday, everyone, Allah gave them the specific quality. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we discussed here Sunday about who? Az-Zubair. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Az-Zubair, inna li kulli nabiyyin hawari, wa hawari hadhi al-umma, wa hawari az-Zubair. My disciple is Zubair. He didn't say Abu Bakr or Umar. That is his special quality. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, what does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say about him? Amin hadhi al-umma, inna li kulli ummatin amin. The most trustworthy person of this ummah is Abu Ubaidah. Talha ibn Ubaidullah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said about him after the battle of Uhud, wajaba Talha. Talha is going to Jannah. One time he said, when you're sitting with his companions, whoever of you wants to look at a man of paradise walking on earth, that is the man. And it was Talha ibn Ubaidullah. Tayyib. Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas, mustajabu da'wah. He is the one the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for him. His duas were never rejected. And also the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he bragged. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, everybody has his uncle, and my uncle is Sa'd ibn Malik. So let each one of you show me his uncle, who's better than me. Because Sa'd was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one of his relations. You understand? Everybody has his quality. You have Abu Dujana, Simak ibn Kharash, who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the battle of Badr, Uhud. Badr. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took out his sword and he said, "Man ya'khudha bihaqqiha." Who's going to take this sword by its right? As Zubair said, so all of us who came forward. And when one narration says, Umar said, "Ma haqqu ya Rasulullah?" What is this right? He said that you fight and not turn back. He says, so all of us, we held back. Abu Dujana, he came forward. He said, "Ana ya Rasulullah, I'm going to take it." He said, "Anta?" He said, "Yes, me." And he took it. And Abu Dujana, he had his banner, like a bandana, yellow one. He tied it on him. When he used to go to war, the Ansar, they say, we used to know Abu Dujana, when he ties his headband, then he's going to fight to death. يُقَاتِلْ حَتَّى الْمَوْتِ. That is how he used to be. And he used to walk bragging on the line, showing people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna هَذَا لَمِشَّى يُبْغِضُهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا فِي مِثْلِ هَذَا الْمَوْقِعِ." It's a type of walking Allah does not like it, except in places like this. They're ready to fight with the kuffar of Quraysh. Zubair said, "I followed him. And I saw he gave the sword its right." Abu Dujana, Simak ibn Kharasha. That is his quality. Khalid bin Walid, radiallahu anhu, he became Muslim late. One time he spoke with Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas and he said things to him. Sa'd came and complained. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said what? La tu'udhu ashabi. Do not, ya Khalid. Don't speak like that to my companions. Meaning this was a special. And Khalid said what? إنهم يقعون في رسول الله فأرد. They speak against me, so I return whatever they speak. And he said, لا تؤذوا خالد, don't harm خالد. فإنه سيف من سيوف الله سله الله على الكافرين. He's one of the swords of Allah. Allah has unleashed it on his on the disbelievers. Everybody had his special. Call it Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. He was the genius. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it known. He said, I knew there's nobody who likes to memorize hadith like you. Everybody had his quality. If you come to the women, who's untouchable? Khadija or Aisha, Sheikh? That debate will last long here. Is the tea ready? Is the tea ready in the... Who, Khadija or Aisha? Allahu Akbar. You know, I try to refrain from these comments these days because I've been warned, you know. Second wife, third wife, I've been warned. But I'm going to say this. The man who has been married more than once, he knows. All of you are wrong. See what he said? You need to learn from him. He said everybody had their special qualities. Khadija during her time, nobody came close. And even after her time, that's why Aisha became jealous. Aisha never met Khadija, yet she was jealous. So like she said, who's this old woman you keep mentioning? That's how a wife talks to a husband, right? The Prophet was gentle. It's like, who's this old woman you keep mentioning? Yet when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith in Sahih Muslim, hadith of Amr ibn al-As, he says, when we're coming back, Amr ibn al-As is another one. He became Muslim late. In the battle of Dhatus Salasil, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put him in charge. So he thought, I'm the best person. When coming back, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, man ahabbaka an-nas, man ahabba an-nas ilayk, who do you love most? And he said, Aisha. Allah. No hesitation. Said Aisha. Say, la, min al-rijal, from the man. I'm talking about the man. He said, Abu, her father, Abu Bakr. Then who? He said, then Umar. He said, then I kept quiet. Everybody had his own special quality. Everybody had his own special quality. That's why when the women of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they ganged up against Aisha and they found a lawyer. Who was the lawyer? Fatima. Fatima, nobody comes close. Nobody comes close. To the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Fatima is the special one. Yes. His daughter. And she used to walk just like her father. Aisha says that. One day she came. She said, Inna nisa'uk, your women, all of them, eight of them, they sent me here. Aisha narrates the hadith. He said, and she came in, and me and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were lying down on our bed. Your women sent me to talk to you about the daughter of Abu Bakr. They ask you to be fair. And we talked about this on Sunday. In terms of spending, the Prophet was fair. But in terms of love, you can't control love. So they sent Fatima. Look how I told you one day, we're going to do a series of lectures on how he dealt with his wives at home, his children. How did the Prophet deal with everybody? Amazing stories, because sometimes we forget they're humans. They were humans. So they gathered together and they said, who can we send for us? I said, oh, Fatima. Nobody comes close like Fatima. So they sent Fatima to speak for them. Eight wives against who? Aisha. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her, oh my daughter, do you love me? She says, yes. So he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then love the one I love. I love her. That's it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one time he had a talk with his other wife, Ummu Salama. And he said, you know, you have to be fair with us. It's just Aisha, Aisha. He said, leave me. Don't bug me about Aisha. Don't bug me about Aisha. Don't disturb me. Because wallahi, the revelation, wahi, never came to me when I was with any woman, meaning while sleeping, except Aisha. Wahi will come while he's sitting down in any house. But while in bed sleeping, Revelation never came to me except in the house on the bed of Aisha. So leave me, she is special. You understand? But I can bring you back to the debate, Sheikh. Let me bring you back. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, one day he was speaking to Khadija, and he said to her, what? Hada Jibril. This is Jibril. You don't see him. I see him. He's giving you salam. And he says to give you glad tidings of a house in Jannah, which has no problem in it. So who's better, Aisha or Khadija? The point is, Ikhwani, Abu Bakr and Umar are number one. And Abu Bakr is one, obviously, as you know. And then Umar, and then Uthman, and then Ali. And then all of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We have to know these people. We have to love them. Loving them is enough to get us into Jannah. Just loving them. Now we'll stop here because our time is up. But I want to make an announcement. First of all, don't leave. As you know, mashallah, the people in this masjid are very kind. There's always refreshments after. So don't leave, please. Number two, we are going to bring back the Wednesday class. Not next Wednesday, though. I still have work, some work I'm doing. That's why I canceled the class. I had promised you that we're going to speak about the Ahlu Baytun Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We're going to discuss Ja'far, Ali, Aqil, Harith, Ubaidah bin Harith, his wives, Fatima, Hassan, Hussein. I'd love to do that. Because it's rarely being done, as you know that. But then the question came here last Sunday and I felt bad. The brothers are still asking, when are we going to do the... No, leave alone the seerah. Don't even take me there. When are we going to do the sifatul salatul Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? The Prophet's prayer described. Because all those emails are still coming. They go online, we only have until ruku'. When are we going to complete that? And I said on Sunday, I don't have time. I have a lot of things to do. So it kept bugging me from Sunday until today. Of course, as you know, we did this book before in Salahuddin, 10 years ago maybe. 10 years ago, easily. Maybe he was there, 1, 2, 3. These three people are there. 10 years ago, alhamdulillah, we read the whole book. We read the book 3 years ago at Abu Huraira. But apparently the videos are lost. So we did almost 40 weeks. And the videos just go to ruku'. So I will leave all the other lectures on the side. And we're going to redo Sifatul Salah, inshallah. From beginning. The Prophet's prayer described with Sheikh Al-Albani and the book of Sheikh Mashhur, Common Mistakes in Salah. We're going to redo that from beginning, inshallah. When? I don't know. When? I don't know. Not next week. For sure not next week. And next week, Friday, most likely there's no class because I'll be traveling. Next week, Friday. No, sorry. Next week, Sunday. Friday, I might be here. I'll tell you on Sunday, actually. This Sunday, I'll tell you. But we're going to redo Sifatul Salah. My point is, and we're going to do Wednesday, Friday, and then Sunday also, just before the Q&A, we're going to do part of it. So when we have 3 days, we'll cover it in shorter time. Instead of doing one day of the week, it'll take another 40 weeks. Taib? So that is what we're going to do. On Sunday, we're going to discuss Sujood al-Sahwa, like we mentioned. The ahkam, the ruling of sujood al-sahwa in salah, prostration of forgetfulness, for around 25 minutes, and then we do our normal Q&A, inshallah. Don't forget to make dua for each other, inshallah. this book, of course, will continue next Friday. Like I said, if I'm here, we'll continue for. Do not leave your papers hanging here, please. Just let's be responsible. You take it with you and you bring it back when we resume the class, inshallah. If you have questions, Sunday, please. If you have questions, Sunday. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك Thank you.